Following the Battle of the Philippine Sea, the American conquest of the Marianas became a hard-fought and bloody land action. The Japanese defenders resisted stoutly, but the islands were taken. Saipan and Tinian were followed by Guam, with the intricate network of cave defenses there being cleared by August the 12th. The fall of the islands and the naval defeat underlined the weakening of Japan's position, though there was no official acknowledgement of the gravity of the situation. Significantly, however, the dramatic events in the Marianas were followed by the resignation of General Tojo's government. Attention now turned toward the Philippines, with the Japanese dedicating priority to their defense, while the Americans prepared to invade. Preliminaries to the main offensive came with the American attacks and occupations of Morotai and the Palau Islands. The invasions were very well practiced affairs, America's domination of the air providing a fairly firm guarantee of success. On the other hand, the tenacity of the Japanese defenders guaranteed that there was a high price to be paid for victory. The occupation of the Palaus gave America new air bases within 500 miles of the Philippines, and the stage was set for the next big move. Where the Americans were going from strength to strength, the losses in the Marianas had left the Japanese fleet carriers almost without planes and fatally stricken by the loss of irreplaceable air crew. The Japanese situation was also being handicapped by fuel shortages, as the flow of oil from Indonesia had slowed to a trickle. The loss of the Philippines would cut off even this and render the fleet immobile. The Imperial High Command was left with no option but to fight in the Philippines with whatever resources it had left. Again, the chiefs in Tokyo prepared an elaborate battle plan. If the carriers were without teeth to fight on, then perhaps they could be the bait to lure an American fleet into range of the battleships. When the American invasion of the island of Leyte sent the Philippines campaign off in earnest, the Tokyo admirals set their plan in motion. The Battle of Leyte Gulf, the largest naval battle of all time, was made up of four distinct actions. A total of 282 ships were engaged, as well as hundreds of aircraft. It began with Admiral Halsey's flat tops attacking the Japanese battleships, the reverse of what the Japanese had planned. Halsey then took his task groups to wipe out the almost planeless Japanese carriers. When the surviving Japanese battleships turned back in two groups to attack, one arm was rebuffed, but the main thrust burst through and bore down on the beachhead.
They looked like pagodas walking on the water. Here they were, coming over the horizon, right straight for us. Well, there wasn't anything to do but to turn around and start running. While this was going on, of course, we were arming the rest of our planes. But in order to launch, we had to turn right back into the Japanese fleet again, because that's where the wind was from. Of course, all this time, we were under fire, you understand?
Confronting the Japanese giants were six puny escort carriers and a handful of destroyers. They had no chance of holding back the Japanese ships, but put up a spirited defense as they retired. The Japanese Admiral Kurita was worried that Halsey would cut off his retreat, unsure of what strength remained in the confusion of ships in the crowded gulf.
In the late morning, after we'd been under fire for over 2 hours, the Japanese Admiral turned around and headed back. I read somewhere that he thought that he was running into the heavy carrier groups.
Even while Kurita was turning away, the first kamikaze attack took place. Admiral Onishi, commanding the air forces in the Philippines, had approached a startled Admiral Toyota with his revolutionary new measure and had been given approval. His request had followed the lone action of Rear Admiral Orima, who had flown a dive bomber into the flight deck of the USS Franklin. His example had spurred so many volunteers that Onishi then sought to formalize the activity and secure official sanction for such desperate action. The Kamikaze's introduction coincided with the demise of the remaining Japanese carriers. Admiral Halsey may have been in error on leading the invasion unprotected, but he managed to get his attacks on the Japanese carriers in, and four of the ships went down. By the time the American air attacks came, the Japanese fleet had only 19 Zeros left to defend it. In the aftermath of the battle, the Japanese Navy could no longer be seen as a significant threat. The American losses had once again been relatively small, and the Philippines invasion had been uninterrupted throughout the naval action. The significant and terrifying arrival of the Kamikazes on the scene was the only gloomy aspect to a campaign that was proceeding smoothly. Kamikaze attacks increased. 23 carriers were hit in 3 months, two escort carriers sinking. Seven fleet carriers had been hit. The damage caused by these strikes ranged from minor to catastrophic. In that time, Admirals Nimitz and Halsey kept the carrier groups hovering around the Philippines, where they were the deciding factor once again. The Kamikazes would have wiped out the invasion fleets, but for the protection of the carrier planes. Troop ships, supply ships, battleships, assault craft, all were just so many targets without command of the air.
Carriers will be back in a moment. To carriers.
The carriers patrolled and attacked. The task groups had swung out in January to punish targets in China and Formosa. The Kamikaze attacks pursued the carriers. Ticonderoga was badly damaged off Formosa on the 21st of January as the fighting around the Philippines finally died down. 4 days later, the last Kamikaze mission from the Philippines was flown. There had been 421 Kamikaze sorties from the islands, with 16 ships sunk and another 87 damaged. These results are unambiguous. The measure was effective. The attacks would keep coming to the end of the war. Kamikaze attacks were measured by the West as the height of insanity, and the expression suicide attacks was used to describe them. Suicide is, however, the wrong word entirely. There was no connotation of hopelessness or despair about the actions of a Kamikaze pilot. He had faith that his actions retained worth and contributed to his country. The Kamikaze's death did not give up life or devalue it. The life was passed on to those who remained. In theory, the Kamikazes ushered in the age of the guided missile. Sweeping down into the anti-aircraft fire, the plane was steered not simply to hit a ship, but to hit the most vulnerable or critical part of a ship. The punch was heavier and more accurate than any bomb. After the Philippines campaign, Admiral Halsey had handed the fleet back to Admiral Spruance and had gone off to prepare the invasion of Japan. Spruance had been preparing the invasions of Iwo Jima and Okinawa as the next steps to be taken. The island of Iwo Jima was invaded on the 19th of February, and fighting continued until the end of March. There was only one sizable Kamikaze attack on the 21st of February. The escort carrier Bismarck Sea was sunk, and Saratoga and four other ships were badly damaged. Even when the ships retired to their base at Ulithi to prepare for the move on Okinawa, the Kamikazes pursued. Randolph was hit at the anchorage in an attack on the 11th of March and suffered considerable damage. She was rammed by a twin-engine bomber carrying a 2,000-pound bomb. The fires were contained and casualties were light. When Admiral Spruance inspected the damage on the Randolph, he would not have been aware of quite what was going to happen at Okinawa. There was no doubt that further kamikaze attacks would come, but the ferocity and volume of the attacks would be another shocking reminder of the Japanese commitment and self-denying faith. Spruance had shown himself at Midway and the Marianas to be a capable, thoughtful leader. But leadership was a limited asset against the onslaught of kamikaze attacks that was to come. Strikes began with attacks on the airfields of Kyushu, the close-range bombardment of the Japanese home islands underlining the increasing helplessness of the defenders. The carrier planes swept the Japanese coast of shipping, large and small, and brushed aside most of the weight of the attacks from Japanese planes. Japanese achieved some revenge on March 19th when several planes managed to barge through defenses and score hits on Enterprise, Yorktown, Wasp, and Franklin. Franklin was terribly damaged. Bombs exploded in the hangar where planes had just been fueled and armed, ready for a raid. And the resulting fires set off a series of explosions that rocked her for 5 hours. Fighting efforts were to see the ship saved, but Franklin suffered 832 men killed and a further 270 injured. Franklin, with some of her crew evacuated, lay stopped and burning in the water, rocked by explosions. Her ordeal was to go on for 2 days, with fires still breaking out a day later when she had finally been taken in tow. As the Americans moved closer to the Japanese homeland, the ferocity of the defense intensified. With the stiffer resistance came a mounting tide of kamikaze attacks. This would reach its peak during the campaign around Okinawa. The Japanese had hoarded a supply of aircraft for a frightening new campaign. This called for massed kamikaze flights to progressively wipe out the American radar picket line of destroyers and then swamp the fleet proper with sheer numbers. They had available over 2,100 planes for this operation, and they were to lose 1,400 of them. The desperate fight to save the Franklin succeeded, and she eventually limped back to the anchorage at Ulithi under her own steam. That she survived the attack and the following explosions and fires is, in view of the damage she suffered, astonishing. Certainly it serves as a testament to the hardiness of the Essex-class carriers and to the care taken in both their design and construction. But she was so badly damaged that she would never be repaired. She set off for her home port, New York, on a long and lonely voyage that would be, effectively, her last. Kamikaze attacks reached such an intensity that Admiral Spruance was forced to reorganize his ships as three task groups instead of four, because there was a constant rotation of carriers back to base for repairs. Fusui started on the 6th of April with an attack by 355 kamikazes and continued to the 12th of May. Over 1,800 kamikaze sorties were flown over this period, and 930 were shot down. 17 ships were sunk and 198 damaged, including 12 carriers and 10 battleships. The conquest of Okinawa proved to be an agonizingly slow and bloody process. With the Japanese defenders holding out more strongly than ever, there was no way to build up land-based air strength, and the carriers were held on station, exposed but essential. Air cover had to be provided. Even with the presence of the carriers, the damage being done was severe. The kamikaze tactic had been born in part because of the shortage of skilled pilots. It was to be the same factor that limited the tactic's effectiveness. The poorly trained reserve pilots not only lacked the skill to survive in aerial combat, they lacked the skill to intercept and ram a ship in the most effective way. They were barely in command of their planes, and the job asked of them required considerable ability, even if their craft wasn't damaged in approach. Kikusui attacks at Okinawa, losses were between 60 and 90% each mission, and wastage at this rate could of course not be sustained for long in pilots or planes. The fury of kamikaze activity had to weaken. Attacks continued to the end of the war, but they became more infrequent and were flown as smaller affairs. Sometimes individual planes would appear, darting to attack. The Japanese war effort was exhausted. Planes and ships sat idle for lack of fuel. The mighty Yamamoto left port with enough oil for a one-way trip to Okinawa, but didn't even get that far. The task force off Japan's shore deployed 14 fleet carriers, four of them British, and six light carriers. They could put up a combined strength of 1,450 aircraft. With this power and the long-range Air Force operations, all Japanese movement ground to a halt. The sky over Japan was dominated by American aircraft, which left the islands isolated. Both sides braced for the resolution. Over 400 ships were sunk or damaged by kamikaze attack in the last 11 months of the war. Though they did not alter the outcome of the conflict, they certainly made their impression. Like the Germans, the Japanese experimented with remote-controlled missiles. But there were so many problems and so little time that these plans were amended to include pilots, to further institutionalize the acceptance of the kamikaze pilot as a disposable component. The Japanese agreed to surrender on the 15th of August, the documents being signed on the 2nd of September. The arrival of Americans in Tokyo had not been fought out in landings. The Japanese had been remorselessly pounded from the air, the constant hammering of the long-range B-29s being punctuated by the concentrated fury of the unpredictable carrier-based swarms. Most Japanese were unaware of the atomic blasts until after the war. But they were all aware of the terror of the constant bombing. The emperor spoke on the 14th, and the nation accepted. Negotiations were brief. There was no bargaining position left. The only concession made to the Japanese was that the emperor's sovereignty would be recognized. The formal signing of the instrument of surrender was ceremonially enacted on the battleship Missouri in Tokyo Harbor. Admiral Nimitz pilots had ordered that full vigilance against kamikaze attacks be maintained to the end, even after Japan's capitulation. Franklin's dreadful ordeal would not be repeated. The last attacks came on the 15th of August, but had no effect. The fighter cover was impenetrable. The battering was over. Peace had been a long time coming, and the price had been massive. The Franklin, back home in New York.
Amazing destructive power. It's glamorous, glorious, and highly dangerous. So strap yourself in for a wild ride with our Wings Over the Sea.
The advent of the aircraft carrier marked a revolution in naval warfare. Carriers became the dominant surface warships in World War II, replacing the battleship. The battleship's power came from its heavy guns, which could hit other ships nearly 30 miles away. A carrier's power came from its airplanes. World War II carrier aircraft could hit targets 200 miles away. Modern carriers can strike targets 1,000 miles away. Today, there are two principal types of aircraft carriers: light small-deck carriers and large full-deck supercarriers. Light carriers, like those used by Britain and the Soviet Union, have small decks. They can operate only about 24 helicopters or vertical takeoff jets. Their specialty is anti-submarine warfare. The United States Navy is the only force operating supercarriers. Supercarriers are the largest surface warships afloat today. They have an air wing of about 100 aircraft, about four times the size of the air wing on a light carrier. Our special focus in this program will be the supercarriers. The supercarrier is a floating city. Turned on its side, it's as large as an 80-story skyscraper. It displaces 80,000 tons. The flat top is a seagoing airport with a crew of 5,000 men. About half the crew operates the ship itself, while the others take care of the aircraft. Supercarriers are the most expensive weapons in today's arsenals. A typical carrier costs about $3.5 billion, not even counting her aircraft. Control of the ship is managed from the island, located on the right side of the vessel. The large flight deck is 4 acres in size. A supercarrier can launch up to 3 aircraft at one time. Below the flight deck is a large hangar deck where aircraft are stored and repaired. Below the hangar deck are the living quarters for most of the crew and the ship's propulsion. Supercarriers can be either conventionally powered or nuclear powered. Nuclear powered carriers can operate for about 10 years without refueling. Modern carriers have surprisingly few weapons aside from their aircraft. Their armament is usually limited to a few Sea Sparrow missile launchers and several 20-millimeter Phalanx Gatling guns, a last-ditch defense against anti-ship missiles. A carrier depends on her aircraft for defense. A supercarrier holds as much firepower as all that available to the United States Navy in World War II. Much of this firepower comes from the nuclear weapons on board. But even without nuclear weapons, the firepower of a carrier is awesome. A typical carrier has about 24 A-6 intruder attack bombers. These two-man bombers can carry as many bombs as the largest heavy bombers of World War II. The intruders are the offensive power of the carrier. The F-14 Tomcats are its defensive shield. Carriers are popularly called bird farms in the Navy due to their flock of airplanes. Carriers extend the military power of a country to distant lands. When Britain recaptured the Falkland Islands, It was carriers that protected the invasion fleet and attacked Argentinian army positions. They are the big stick of foreign policy. Carriers do not operate in isolation, but as part of a carrier battle group. A carrier battle group includes other types of warships, such as destroyers, which provide defense against hostile submarines and air cover against anti-ship missiles. Carrier pilots from other military aviators is the skill required to operate from the small flight deck. A carrier is so short that a steam catapult is used to fire the aircraft off the carrier deck. There are usually four catapults on each carrier. The front landing gear of the aircraft is locked into a device called a shuttle. When the catapult is fired, enormous steam pressure is released. This yanks the shuttle and the aircraft across the deck at over 100 miles an hour. A Navy aviator describes the experience.
Oh, it's a blast. It's a kick. You're sitting in there and you're getting all set. You know, your heart's going mile a minute, and the pilot's looking for certain signals from the deck crew that everything's all set up, that the nose gear is all hooked up and everything. And when the pilot's all set to go, he gives the deck crew a smart salute, and he puts his head back, and you wait 1 or 2 seconds till the catapult officer presses the button, and then it's just a kick. You know, it's just a big kick. Tremendous acceleration from 0 to upwards of 120, 130 miles an hour knots in 2 seconds. And then as soon as you get off the boat, it's like everything stops because you don't have the acceleration anymore. You just have the speed. And it's sort of like you're floating. You know, you got to look at your instruments to make sure you're flying. Oh, yeah, okay, I'm flying. And then it's a blast. It's a real good time.
The tasks of the deck crew may not be as glamorous as the pilots, but they're every bit as vital. Because of the noise of the jet engines, deck crews coordinate their actions by visual means. A pilot can tell the function of the deck crew by the color of their uniforms.
It's very hard to communicate. It's so loud, so everything a lot is done by sight. And you can tell who people are by the colors of them. Examples are the people who wear purple are the fuel. They deal with refueling all the aircraft. The people in brown are the plane captains. They assist the crew in pre-flighting the aircraft and help them get all set. The people in yellow are the plane directors. They're the ones who move the aircraft. The aircraft doesn't go anywhere unless the plane captains tell them where to go. The men in green are the arresting gear and the catapult crew. They're the ones who hook the plane up to the catapult, and they're the ones who make sure that the landing gear is all set to go. And the people in white are safety. The landing signal officer at the end of the deck wears white. They're involved in safety. So just by looking at the colors, it's very easy to tell what they do and whether they're supposed to be where they're supposed to be and where you're supposed to be. And it makes it a lot easier on the air crew and makes everything flow smooth.
During catapult launches, the pilots are just along for the ride. It's the carrier landings that demand all the skill. Carrier landings are often described by pilots as controlled crashes. 20 tons of airplane hit the deck at over 100 miles an hour. Landings are what separate carrier aviators from all other pilots.
The landing, on the other hand, is where all the skills involved. That's where the pilots make their money. That's where unfortunately the accidents happen around the carrier. Daytime landings become fun after a while because they're a real challenge, but the nighttime landings, I don't think there's too many carrier pilots out there that'll tell you that landing at night on a boat is fun. It's scary, it's demanding, you get a pasty taste in your mouth and break out in a cold sweat, and you're just glad to be home when the airplane hits the deck. The big problem is attitude reference. When you land at night, there's no depth perception. There's no sense of high or low. There's none of that seat of the pants kind of feel you're doing it all on instruments. and that includes flying the meatball. There's you can't barely see the deck, so you're just, everything's visual, and your head's trying to screw you up. Your ears are messed up, your sense of balance is fouled up, and you're trying to fight all these bad influences just to get yourself home. So I'd say the landing is obviously the more difficult one.
Flying the meatball is naval aviator slang for a system of lights used to guide the pilot onto the deck. There is a yellow bar called the meatball in the center and a row of green datum lights. If the ball is above the green lights, the plane is too high, below, and it's too low. On the deck are four arresting wires. If the pilot flies the ball, his plane should land near the third one, called the three wire. The wire is caught by an arresting hook at the rear of the plane. Landing takes tremendous concentration. The carrier's offensive power comes from its attack squadrons. The air wing can carry out missions against land targets or ships 1,000 miles away. At the center of any attack mission is the Grumman A-6 Intruder. Lieutenant James Buss explains its role.
We call ourselves the spearhead of the attack. We're the offensive punch of the air wing. We're a medium attack aircraft and carry a lot of bombs in harm's way. Our job is to be the guys that go across the beach, that do the attack. Most of the other airplanes you see out here on the carrier are out here to support us, the fighters, to protect the carrier. The light attack aircraft do a lot of anti-radiation kind of thing, SAM suppression, we call it. They shoot the anti-radiation missiles, the EA-6Bs. They take care of the electronic countermeasures.
The most deadly enemy of aircraft such as the Intruder is the anti-aircraft missile. Most modern anti-aircraft missiles rely on radar to find the target and to guide the missile against the aircraft. Radar has one particular weakness. It can be blocked by terrain features, so it cannot see aircraft approaching from low altitudes. The Intruder exploits this blind spot by flying very low to the ground.
A-6 is a low-level attack aircraft, so we're low-level. We fly at altitudes. We can go as low as 50 feet, 20, as low as the pilot wants, pretty much. It takes a lot of skill to do that, and they're very skilled pilots. We're usually low. We train about 200 feet, 500 feet in that area. Speeds from 360 to 500 knots.
Flying a jet attack aircraft like the Intruder is more than a single pilot can handle. The other seat in the aircraft is filled by a bombardier navigator.
I'm a bombardier navigator. I fly on the right seat. The pilot, of course, is the left seat. On his side, he has all the normal flight controls of any aircraft, stick and throttle. Any pilot that flies a Cessna 150 would probably be fairly familiar with most of the stuff on his side of the airplane. There's a few boxes in there that he wouldn't understand right off the bat, just to make his job a little easier. The right side of the airplane, the bombardier navigator side, my side, consists of a radar, a computer, an inertial navigation system, and a forward-looking infrared turret display, which looks like a little TV.
The small sensor below the nose of the aircraft is a special thermal imaging sight, which helps the aircraft fly at night.
We can see the difference between buildings, people, convoys, trucks, ships, any of that. And that's what makes us able to bomb so accurately at night, which gives us the element of surprise and things such as that. What allows us another aspect that the A6 has that gives us great capability is what they call SRTC. It's a terrain clearance. It allows us, it takes whatever the radar is looking at and gives a three-dimensional view on the pilot side. So we can fly in and around mountains, and I can see that on the radar, and the pilot can see it on his three-dimensional presentation. And so we're both navigating through the mountains. We're both cross-checking. I don't accidentally fly us into a mountain because he can see it right there, and vice versa. And so with those two capabilities, it gives us a tremendous advantage, element of surprise. We can fly at night in any weather.
Enemy radars and missiles, a strike force is accompanied by the EA-6B Prowler. The Prowler locates enemy radars with its sensitive electronics. Once identified, it can jam the radar by using strong electronic signals. An ordinary radar scope looks like this. The small green blips show the location of incoming aircraft. But when jammed with electronic noise from the Prowler, the screen becomes cluttered and unreadable. To permanently eliminate the radar, an F-18 Hornet can carry special anti-radiation missiles that home in on the radar beams. Enemy aircraft can also pose a threat to an attack mission. To protect against enemy fighters, F-18 Hornets escort the bombers to the target. It is equally adept at dogfighting and ground attack. With the mission over, the planes return to the carrier. On long-range missions, it's often necessary for the aircraft to refuel. The carrier has its own refueling aircraft, based on a modified version of the Intruder called the KA-6 Tanker. The KA-6 spools out a fuel line behind it. Each of the carrier aircraft have a special refueling boom on the nose of the aircraft. The aircraft carefully position each other, catching the drogue from the refueling line on the nose probe. Precision flying is an essential skill of the carrier aviator. Battle of Midway in 1943, naval aircraft have proven to be the most deadly opponent of surface warships. The carrier's primary defense against enemy aircraft is the jet fighter. The design of carrier fighters is determined by the type of aircraft likely to threaten the carrier. The F-14 Tomcat was designed to protect the carrier against long-range patrol bombers firing cruise missiles, like the Soviet Tu-95 Bear bomber. The cruise missiles fired by the Bear are as large as a fighter plane and are designed specifically to attack carriers. These missiles contain a ton of high explosive and can be launched over 100 miles from the carrier. The F-14 Tomcat was designed to protect the carrier from this type of weapon. The carrier's radar can search the skies for enemy bombers, but the radar emits radiation that can help an enemy locate the carrier. So in wartime, the radar would often be silent. Instead, the E-2C Hawkeye would be sent aloft to hunt for enemy aircraft. Once the Hawkeye had located the enemy bombers, the F-14 Tomcat would be sent into action. Modern naval naval air combat bears little resemblance to the dogfights of World War II. It is a popular misconception that the Tomcat was designed primarily for close-range dogfights. In most engagements, the Tomcat crew is unlikely to see its opponent. Its powerful radar can locate bombers over 200 miles away. It's designed to destroy the bomber with a long-range Phoenix missile before the bomber can attack the carrier. The most remarkable feature of the Tomcat is that it can locate and attack six targets almost simultaneously. The Tomcat is also an effective dogfighter. It is armed with a Gatling gun and short-range missiles to challenge small, maneuverable enemy fighters. Tomcat pilots are regularly trained in aggressive dogfighting maneuvers. The Tomcat's smaller cousin is the F-18 Hornet. The Hornet was developed to bridge the gap between the specialized Tomcat fighter and the intruder bomber. The Hornet can be used either as a fighter to support the Tomcat or as a light bomber to support the intruder. The F-18 Hornet is well designed for the traditional dogfighting role. It is smaller and more agile than the Tomcat, even though it does not have the Tomcat's range or firepower. The Hornet is armed with a gun for dogfighting and strafing, and with the Sparrow and Sidewinder missiles. Carriers have changed little over the past two decades, despite modest improvements in their electronics. Where change has come is not in the ship itself, but in its aircraft. Critics have charged that in an age of anti-ship missiles, supercarriers are too big and too vulnerable. But for the foreseeable future, there is no other ship with such an awesome combination of offensive striking power and offensive self-protection.
Northern tip of Oahu, a radar station is turned on by an army trainee practicing on his own time. 7:06. A large blip appears on his screen. Something must be wrong with the equipment, he feels. But finally, he reports a large number of planes coming in from the north. He is told to disregard them. They must be our own. He continues to watch. At 7:15, the planes are 92 miles away. 7:30, 47 miles. 7:39, 22. In the United States, a Sunday like any other. Before it is through, the lives of most Americans will be changed forever. Kingfisher bombing Berlin, the Luftwaffe learning Britain. The White Cliffs of Dover is a jukebox favorite. But more popular are Green Eyes and Blue Champagne. The war is thousands of miles away. At the Polo Grounds in New York, a crowd of 55,000 are watching the Dodgers defeat the Giants. The temperature is 37 degrees. The Midwest is blanketed with snow. Milk is 9 cents a quart. Bread, 9 cents a loaf. At the A&P, coffee is 2 pounds for 37 cents. A porterhouse steak, 29 cents a pound. These prices, like many old familiar things, will soon disappear. The island of Oahu sleeps peacefully. A few fishing boats may be seen, but no offshore patrols of any kind. It is an ordinary Sabbath morn. On the battleships moored in harbor, the men are just waking. On the airfields, the planes remain neatly grouped together under the brightening sky. Counterattack, the airfields are hit first. The planes parked closely together make an excellent target. At 7:57, the main target lies below. Battleship Row. Japanese torpedoes specially designed for shallow water will now prove their worth. After the initial shock of attack, the Navy begins to strike back. Japanese, the loss of a few planes is insignificant. Attack is proceeding even better than planned. In 15 minutes, Hawaiian air power is virtually wiped out. Now, the final assault on the Pacific Fleet. Pacific Fleet is broken. Sunk the battleships Arizona, Oklahoma, West Virginia, California. Damaged the Maryland, Pennsylvania, Nevada, Tennessee. Lost the lives of 20. 2,400 American servicemen. Responsibility for the Japanese success will be inconclusively placed at many doors. Washington, the commanders at Pearl Harbor, the American people themselves. But on December 7th, one thing is certain. Although the success of their attack far exceeds their expectations, the Japanese have made a fatal blunder. For out of the smoke and ashes, out of the shame of defeat, will rise a divided people become whole, brought at once together by the events of this single day.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. Yesterday, the Japanese government also launched an attack against Malaya. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Hong Kong. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Guam. Last night, Japanese forces attacked the Philippine Islands. Last night, the Japanese attacked Wake Island. And this morning, the Japanese attacked Midway Island. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
America becomes united by a common purpose. Clouds of confusion and dissension have disappeared. In their place, resolution, unanimity, and a promise shared to win the war. As always, war means the separation from loved ones and an uncertain future. Japanese believe the United States will settle for a negotiated peace. But they fail to understand they're dealing with a changed America they themselves have shocked into action. The ultimate victory is won. It will not come easily, but for the men at the fighting front and for those they left behind, the bitter memory of Pearl Harbor and December 7th cannot and will not be erased. Today at Pearl Harbor, a monument stands the sunken hull of the USS Arizona, which went down on December 7th with more than 1,100 men. Every morning of the year, a color guard comes to raise the Arizona's flag, for she is still a commissioned ship of the U.S. Navy. Her monument is dedicated to those Americans who made the ultimate sacrifice for their country on December 7th, 1941. God make his face to shine upon them and grant them peace. ¶¶